as we sing those simple words, Jesus, you are good. We sing something that's profound. By nature, you are what we're not, and that's good. You are good. We give you all the praise and all the glory. Lord, if there's somebody in the audience, God, that's just not there right now, would you tune their hearts to sing your praise, God? Fix our eyes on you. Fix our eyes on Jesus. You've done it through song. You've done it through prayer. You've done it through communion. Now do it through your word as it's preached. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated.
Scripture reading this morning will come from John chapter 4, verses 1 through 26. Now, when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee, and he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside this well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it was that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty nor have to come here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." This is God's word.
In submission under your word. It holds authority over our lives. In submission to King Jesus, who, as the word became flesh, holds authority over our lives. I pray that you would help me, God, as a man being under authority, to speak authoritatively as one under authority, and just not as one who stands over authority over your word. Lord, keep me true to the message of your text. Keep me tethered to your word, God. Give me a teachable spirit so that I'd be open to being taught by you, even as I teach others, that you would Help me personally to live a holy life, to pay close attention to my lifestyle, my conduct, my doctrine. As Paul told Timothy, I pray that you would do that for me. I pray for those who hear that they would hear in view of eternity with open and receptive hearts that's able to receive the implanted word, which is able to save their souls. For those who aren't saved, that they would see Jesus, I pray, in a remarkable way. As a man of radical character and nature and love, who seeks not his own glory nor the glory of man, but the glory of God, the glory of the Father. Make us men and women that walk in his likeness, that are conformed to his image, that love as he loved. And I pray this, that you would do this for us and much more. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so this is the second sermon of four in John chapter 4. The first was Jesus, the Messiah. This one's called Jesus the Radical. Next week, we talk about Jesus, the fountain of living water, and then we end with Jesus, the Lord of the harvest. And I think sermons like this are important because of our tendency as humans to fashion God in our own image and after our own likeness. If we're not careful, we can get caught into the trap of thinking that Jesus Christ, the man who died for us, the God-man who died for us, was exactly like us. White, democracy-loving, either Republican or Democrat or independent or liberal or progressive or moderate or conservative or alt-right or Black Lives Matter. I mean, this is the problem we have as humans. We take Jesus, the one who died for us, and we make him exactly like we are. And texts like this in John 4 keep us from doing that because it shows us that there has, in Jesus Christ, never been anyone more like us who is more different from us. That's who Jesus is as a man. No one's more like us than Jesus Christ, and no one is more different from us than Jesus Christ. Jesus doesn't fit into any popular box of any generation because he didn't fit into the popular boxes of his own generation. He didn't fit into his associates' boxes of modernity. He didn't fit in with the Pharisees, didn't fit in with the Sadducees. He just didn't fit in at all. It stands to reason, then, that he doesn't fit in with Republicans, and he doesn't fit in with Democrats, and he doesn't fit in with progressive or liberals or social justice advocates. Any popular box that we try to put Jesus in, he's just not going to fit. He's just too radical for that. In fact, Jesus was so radical that his contemporaries, twice in the Gospel of John, called him demon-possessed. They look at the way he lived his life, who he spoke with, what he stood for, the way he handled himself, and they said, this man has a demon. John chapter 8 and verse 48. Are we not right in saying that you are a Samaritan and have a demon? John chapter 10 and verse 20. See, this man has a demon. Can you imagine someone who is so different from us, interacting with them, seeing how they live, and then all of us coming to the conclusion that he is so off the charts, weird, and radical that he's just got a demon. This man is demon-possessed. Look at who he talks to. Look at who he eats with. Look at what he does. Look at how he loves. Look at how he doesn't care about the glory of man. Demon, he's possessed by a demon. In fact, in every gospel, the Pharisees attribute Jesus' working to demonology. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So we asked this question at the beginning of the sermon. It's the only one I want to answer, and it's this. What is it that makes Jesus so radical? What is it about Jesus that makes him so different from anyone else that's ever walked the face of this earth? And so that's the question we're going to ask, and we're going to answer it. But I want to give you some proofs from this text of why Jesus is radical. And the immediacy of Jesus' radicalness is just overwhelming. Because we know from verses 1 through 26 that Jesus is different from us because of the conversation that he has with the Samaritan woman. It touches on three taboo subjects. Race, religion, and gender. Which is amazing to me, especially in light of current events, especially the ones that happened in Virginia just yesterday. And that
Thousands of years after this text was written and after this occurred, as people, we're still dealing with the same stuff. We're dealing with race, religion, gender equality. It hasn't changed. We're no better off in Athens, Alabama, or in the United States of America than the people were in the Gospel of John, in the town of Sychar, Samaria, and in Jerusalem. We still had the same racial, gender, and religious prejudices that hold us captive that they did. And so the topics we don't talk about with our closest friends, race, religion, and gender, are the very topics that Jesus brings up with a complete stranger that he's never met. He's never met this person. So automatically, Jesus is, he is something else. He talks about the things no one wants to talk about, especially today. The racially, religious, and gender charged situation in Sychar, Samaria is obvious from the text. You don't even have to know any history to feel the tension. Like, I don't even have to set up any history about what Samaritans are and how they came about for you to feel this tension. John is a good author. He writes so that we can feel it. So just look at this, race, right? John 4, verses 7 through 9. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, being a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings," literally, "do not have things in common with Samaritans." So automatically, you don't have to know anything about a Samaritan to know that this is a racially charged situation. The Jews don't have anything to do with Samaritans. But Jesus, being a Jew, does. Look at religion, John 4, 19 through 22. The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship." Now, this seems like it's out of place because Jesus confronts her with, "Bring your husband and come here. I don't have a husband." You're right in saying you don't have a husband. You've had five, and the man you have now is not your husband. So it kind of seems like she's dodging that a little bit. I don't think she is. We're going to see why at the end. I think this is a very relevant question having in regards to race, religion, and gender. So hold on. I'm going to show why at the very end. But Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father." So there's an issue in religion. My people say we worship here on this mountain. Your people say that we worship there on that one. Last, look at gender. Verse 27. Just then his disciples came back. They marveled that he was talking with a woman. Jesus. Psst. Peter. Talking with a woman for. So you don't have to know much about history to know that Jesus is off the charts radical in John chapter 4. Race, religion, gender, all that good stuff we battle with today in modernity, right here in this text, and Jesus, he navigates them all beautifully. You don't have to know any background information, but I'm going to give it to you anyway, because a little background information helps. What is a Samaritan? Where do they come from? Well, the Samaritans were descendants of two groups. This is really brief. The remnant of native Israelites that were deported after the fall of the northern kingdom, which is Israel. So when you go to the Old Testament and you read about Israel and Judah, Israel's the northern kingdom, Judah's the southern kingdom. And Israel, the northern kingdom, is overthrown by Assyria, all right? And they're deported. They're deported out. Judah falls, but Judah falls much later in the scheme of redemptive history. So Israel, the kingdom of Israel falls. There are Jewish, ethnic Jews there, right? But they're deported. They weren't deported after the fall of the northern kingdom. Then foreign colonists that were brought in from Babylonia and Media by the Assyrian conquerors to settle the land, they intermarried with the Jews that were not imported, and they had offspring. There's the racial inequality there. So to a Jew, a Samaritan is what they would call a half-breed, or an interracial marriage, or more crudely, a mixed marriage, or a marriage that produces mixed children. That's a crude way of saying it, but that's the situation between the Jews and the Samaritans. The Jews are we are ethnically pure Jews, and you're just half breeds, marrying the inhabitants of the land. You're half Jews, and so there's a lot of racial tension going on here. And it brings up the issue of race. Yet Jesus walks into the middle of this racially charged situation and does the unthinkable. The unthinkable. He asks for a drink from her bucket, which prompts her to say, "How in the world is it that you, being a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria?" And then John gives us this parenthetical note, "For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." I hate the way that the ESV translates this. I don't understand why they did it, but it literally means, or literally says, Jews don't have things in common with Samaritans. The point that he's trying to make is this, or that she's trying to make is this: why are you asking me for a drink from my bucket? Jews don't use the same buckets as Samaritans. They don't eat off the same plates. They don't use the same utensils. It's an issue of race that's caused these two groups of people to not have things in common. A Jew would be considered unclean if he were to drink from a Samaritan's bucket. Another, or to put it in terms we can understand, some of you more so than others, it'd be like if Jesus were around and he were white. I know Jesus isn't white. I know some of you, your dreams are crushed. Jesus is not white. I'm sorry. But if he were white and he lived in Athens, Alabama, in the 50s, it'd be like him going and getting an ice cream cone at Cream Delight and then walking around the side of the building where there are two fountains there. One says white, the other says colored. And he goes and talks to this African-American woman and says, "Excuse me, ma'am, can I have a drink from your cup? Or can I have a drink from your colored fountain?" And all the white people stand back and go, "What's he? This is what he's doing. This is the kind of racially charged situation that Jesus walks into. I'll drink after you. I want to drink from your bucket." He is radical. This man is radical. He didn't see color. There's an equality, a love there. A love for something that just allows him to go after people because they're just people, because they're image bearers. That's what matters to Jesus. So, issue of race, Jesus is so kind, so instructive. But there's also the issue of religion, right? Theological opposition between the Samaritans and the Jews. This issue of where we're supposed to worship is a really good question for a woman of Samaria to ask for a prophet, to ask of a prophet. Because after the exile, all right, of Judah, the southern kingdom, the Samaritans put obstacles in the way of the Jewish restoration of Jerusalem. So the Samaritans made it hard politically for the Jews to have any kind of temple restoration in Jerusalem. In 128 BC, also, the Samaritans helped the Syrians in their war against the Jews. So this is a long-standing conflict. But in 128 BC, the Jewish high priest retaliated and burned the Samaritan temple on Mount Gerizim. So they had a temple set up on Mount Gerizim, a shrine where they worshipped. And the Jews, in order to get back at the Samaritans for aiding the Assyrians in the war, destroyed that worshiping place. And the Samaritan woman, she knows her history, right? "Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us his well and drank from it, as did his sons and in his livestock?" I mean, she's rooted in the history of her people. It would be a fair question to ask. "Well, what mountain are you supposed to worship? You Jews destroyed our worship place. We think you were supposed to worship here. You say we're supposed to worship there." So there's an issue of religion here, but there's also an issue of, in regards to worship, but there's also an issue of what we call canonicity, what is actually deemed authoritative scripture. So the Samaritans had their own little Pentateuch, the first five books of the Hebrew Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, and they held that as authoritative and binding, where the Jews had their whole Hebrew Bible, not in the order that we have it in today. It was in a different order, but same canon. And so the Jews held to that canon, included history, prophets, and things like that. And the Samaritans said, "No, we just go by the first five books," which is why Jesus says, "You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews." So he's saying there's a greater revelation out there that we have as Jewish people that points to me as the Messiah. You don't have that. You have it in Moses. He wrote of me, but salvation is from this Jewish people, this authoritative bind that the Hebrew Bible has on us as Jews. So He deals with issues of religion. Issue of gender, right? So went and saw Fiddler on the Roof. Is it 4 weeks ago, Beth? Tradition, 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 tradition. Oh, it's such a good little show. But that opening song there, Tradition, that it's steeped in throughout that entire performance. It was put on by the Bank Street Players, Princess Theater. Much better than I expected. Beth was really, really critical of going. She doesn't have the sophisticated taste that I have and the theater and just things of this world, you know. Just, I'm kind of on an upper echelon here, you know, and Beth is just, anyway. She was pleasantly surprised. I bring that up because Fiddler on the Roof was set in the Pale of Settlement of Imperial Russia, 1905, all right, 1905. And Perchik, who's a Marxist, suggests in this play at one point that there is nothing wrong with teaching women the Torah. To which the rabbi's son proclaims Perchik to be a radical. Oh no, a radical! 1905. I mean, that's just the Jewish history taught that the fathers were responsible for learning the Torah, and they were responsible for teaching their sons the Torah. And women, for the most part, weren't taught those things. Most rabbis considered it sinful to talk or to teach a woman, although not all Jews held that view. Most of them did. It was around in 1905 as they held to their traditions. But there was no glass ceiling with Jesus at all. I mean, you read the Gospel of John, and Jesus is teaching women. And he's teaching men. He teaches Mary, right? Mary's sitting at Jesus' feet. She's learning. Martha comes to Jesus and says, tell my sister to help me, which is a very Jewish thing to do. To which Jesus replies, don't hinder her. She's chosen the good part. So Jesus is radical. He does things like teach women. That's a big deal, even though it may not be to us. And the disciples are shocked, right? That he spoke with a woman, yet no one said, what do you seek, or why are you talking to her? So, Jesus is radical. He does things no one else does. He breaches and breaks down issues of race and religion and gender. He breaks through walls. He shatters glass ceilings. He teaches us how to love one another equally and to seek justice, to love mercy, to walk humbly with God. And yet, none of these things that I just mentioned are what make him radical. None of them. Because what I've just described to you, I'm gonna term this as social justice Jesus. So those of you who are abreast with what's going on in the world right now, this is social justice Jesus. Right? I mean, that's what he does. He battles for women, minorities, the oppressed, social justice Jesus. But that's not what makes him radical. They are a byproduct of him being radical. That is a major difference. Jesus does these things because he's radical. These things don't, him doing these things doesn't make him radical. He's radical because the reason that we know he's radical is because he does these things. So what is it that makes Jesus radical? This is what I think. This is the whole sermon hinges on this right here. Ready? So if you've tuned out, tune back in. Jesus, even though he was a man, was not in love with the praise or glory of man. He was in love with the glory of God. That's what makes him radical. Before John tells us anything about social justice Jesus, he tells us this. John chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. Now when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee, and he had to pass through Samaria. This is almost, to me, it's more shocking than anything that I read about in his conversation with the Samaritan woman. Popularity. Jesus' name is in lights. Someone greater than John the Baptist is here. He's making more disciples. He's baptizing more people, and he walks away from it. He walks away from the thing that makes most people tick. Praise. Praise me. Make much of me. walks away. So we're told before we're told anything about social Jesus, and then after we're told everything we need to know about social Jesus, look at what John mentions in verses 43 through 44. After 2 days, he departed for Galilee. Why? Why did Jesus leave Sychar, Samaria? Everybody's coming. Everybody's believing. It's no longer what because of what you said, Samaritan woman at the well, that we believe. For we have heard him for ourselves and come to know he's the Savior of the world. Fields are white for harvest, Jesus says. Sower and reaper are rejoicing together, but Jesus is gone after 2 days. Why? Look at the four in verse 44. Jesus departed. He departed. After 2 days, he departed for Galilee. For, or because, Jesus himself had testified that a prophet has no honor in his hometown. I'm going home because I don't have any honor there. So this section is bookended by a Jesus that runs from praise into dishonor. Very important. Jesus walked away from the glory of man because he sought the glory of God. And this is the most radical thing about Jesus. It's what gets him killed. No one gives a rip about how he treated this woman at the well, as far as Jewish people go. That's not why he died. You talk to a Samaritan woman and ask for a drink from her bucket. We're going to kill you. It wasn't the religious or the gender barriers that he overcame that caused people to have a problem with him. Their issue with Jesus is the reason that he crossed all of those barriers. And it's this: he is free from the glory of man that makes race, religion, and gender definitive qualities. The reason that we make so much of race as people is because we seek the glory of a unified people that are just like us. It's idolatry. It's this deep craving to be accepted because the color of our skin or our hair or our eyes. It's seeking the glory of man that causes us to clump up together in our groups and be racist. And Jesus is completely free of that prejudice. He doesn't seek that kind of glory. He seeks the glory that comes from God. It's this glory of man that causes us to pin male and female against one another and to prop up one group and diminish or dehumanize the other. It's this praise of man to be supreme, to be in authority, to be in control that Jesus is free of. So he walks into any situation free from the pull that somebody has to look like me or be the same sex as me or have the same religion as me for them to be like me. That's why he's radical. That's why all the ceilings break, all the walls fall, is because he is after a glory that is not human in nature, but godly in nature. Doesn't look on the color of skin or someone's gender or someone's religion. Doesn't look at those things to determine value. Let me show you why I say this. John 10, 31 through 33. Just flip over there. We're going to go John 10, John 5. I didn't just pull this out of nowhere. John 10, 31 through 33. The Jews pick up stones to stone Jesus. And Jesus answered them, "I've shown you many good works from the Father. For which of them are you going to stone me?" And the Jews replied, "It's not for a good work that we're going to stone you, but for blasphemy, because you, being a man, make yourself God." Seems like a noble charge, doesn't it? It seems like the Jews are zealous for God's glory. You're defaming the glory of God, Jesus, because you're a man and you're saying that you're God. And we all know that you diminish God's glory if a man becomes God. We're not going to stand for that. We are protectors of this true and living God. Sounds like a noble cause. But here's the problem. John tells us before we get to John chapter 10, that this is not what the Jews are zealous for. They look like they're zealous for God's glory, like they're going to protect it. Look at John 5:44. I'll give you time to just turn back there. If you want to see what drives these people who say, you being a man, make yourself God, we can't stand for that. God's glory is too precious. If you want to see what they're driven by, look at John 5:44, where Jesus writes this. How can you believe when you receive glory, praise, adoration from one another, and do not seek the glory that comes from the only God? What they seek is the adoration and the praise and the glory of man. The glory of man drives everything that they say and everything that they do, even what they say to Jesus in John 10. You being a man, make yourself God. What this means is this. Their opposition to Jesus is rooted in his difference to them. They don't reject Jesus' claim to divinity because it diminishes the glory of God. They reject his claim to divinity because it diminishes their own glory. He's so different from them that even though he's a man, in his claim to be God, he is a rival claim to their throne. They are God in their own minds. This is the point. If Jesus were like them and he sought the glory of man and he claimed to be God, they would accept that claim. Because someone like them, in their own image, with their own prejudices, would be God. But because he's so different from them, his claim to be God rivals their own claim to deity. You're so different from us that it's impossible for us to be God and you to be God. Therefore, you're blaspheming because you don't seek what we seek. That's what they're saying. That's the truth of the matter. But they frame it as if they're protecting God's glory when they're really protecting their own. You're not racist like we are. You're not chauvinist like we are. You're not intolerant like we are. You can't be God like we are. And I didn't pull this from the air either. Go back to John 5, look at verse 43. Jesus says this, I have come in my Father's name, and you do not receive me. If another comes in his own name, you will receive him. If another one comes seeking what you seek, your glory, your praise, his own name, you'll receive that guy because he's just like you. But the reason you reject me is because I don't come seeking what they seek. Your rejection of me as God is because I'm different than you as God. How can you believe when you receive glory from one another and do not seek the glory that comes from the only God? Everyone else worships one another. Half-breed Samaritans, they're not pure like us ethnic Jews. Those African-American people, they're not like us white people. Those poor people, they're like us wealthy people, seeking the glory from their own groups, their own neighborhoods, their own skin color, their own religious beliefs, seeking all that praise that comes from being a Christian or Muslim or an agnostic or an atheist, right there in the group. Yes, 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 every group seeking their own praise, every group. Their words and actions, Jesus' words and actions, ready? Threaten what men worship. Like race and gender and religion, which is why Jesus answers the woman's question about worship. It's not like she just pulled it down from the... She may have pulled it out of the blue, but the reason Jesus answers this question about worship is because at the heart of worship are issues like race and gender and religion. People that seek their own glory, the glory of man, will worship the color of their skin. They will worship their identified gender. They will worship their religious affiliation. Because they seek the glory of man, which finds its identity in things like that, rather than seeking the glory of God, which finds its identity in the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus is saying, I'm more than happy to answer your questions about worship, because worship is at the heart of all this junk, race, religion, and gender. If I can set you free from the praise of man, I can set you free from racism. I can set you free from bigotry. I can set you free from discrimination. I can set you free from social injustice. I can set you free, because you won't find identity in those things anymore. You'll find identity in me, and you can worship. This text is, that's why he answers this question about worship. It's at the heart of every wall he's tearing down and every ceiling he's shattering. It's worship. It's understanding the glory of God as it relates to the glory of man and why we discriminate and judge the way we do. It's because in our minds, if we're white and middle class and Republican, so is God. And everything against it must fall. It's idolatry. So, because Jesus loves the glory of God, and this is the point of application, and this is the point of the message, the Word goes to places and comes to people that it normally wouldn't. Because Jesus is radical, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, the Word comes to us. That's the point of John 4. We want to cast ourselves in John 4. Here is who we are in John 4. We are the woman. We're not Jesus. We're the woman. Bone dry. Thirsty at the well. Thirsty. Dying of thirst. Don't even know we're thirsty spiritually. We're the woman. Discriminating. Being comfortable around people that are our same skin color, living in neighborhoods around people that have the same income as we do, judging people that don't have what we have. We're the woman. You gain our identity by our race, by our gender, by our religious affiliation. This is who we are. And if Jesus were like us, the Word would only go to Jewish people. But it doesn't. Because Jesus is free from the glory of man that wants to shut itself off from everyone else that's not like them. The Word goes everywhere, we don't. That's the good news. What Jesus does in Sychar Samaria is a parable that shows us what he does in Athens, Alabama. Praise God that Jesus, even though he's not a white Republican or Democrat or progressive or liberal or moderate or conservative, thank God he comes to us. Thank God he's not like us. He would never come to us if he were like us. That's the point of this text. The Word goes where it normally wouldn't, because Jesus seeks what the world does not seek, the glory of God instead of the glory of man. And because Jesus seeks the glory of God and dies for the glory of God, he dies for the good of man and eventually the glory of man. As we are caught up into glory with Jesus and are being transformed into that same image which we behold, the resurrected yet crucified King, from one to glory to the next for all of eternity. All because Jesus doesn't look at people the way we look at people, doesn't think about people the way we think about people, doesn't act towards people the way we act towards people, because he's radically different. We too will one day be radically different. Praise God. Let's pray. Almighty God and Father, we thank you for the Word became flesh, who dwelt among us, Jesus Christ our Lord. We thank you that he's not like us, that he doesn't judge the way that we judge, that his allegiance is not to a color of skin or to gender or to religion or to socioeconomic status or to any other thing that we place on which we place importance. We're thankful that his allegiance is to your glory and glory alone, because in so doing, the Word has come to a people to whom it otherwise would have never come. God, we are like this Samaritan woman, adulterers, hiding from the truth, hiding our actions, thirsty, in need of a Savior. So we come to you, Lord, to drink and to be satisfied. And I pray a special prayer for those who don't know who you are, who've never named the name of Jesus Christ on their lips or pondered the beauty and the glory of his person in their hearts, that you would open their eyes, O Holy Spirit, to show the beauty of Jesus Christ lifted up, dying for the whole world, because he sought not the glory that comes from man, but the glory that comes from God. Make us people who seek such a glory. Make us people who trust in such a Word. We pray in Jesus' name.